Thank you for thousands and thousands of journeys that were made. Thank you for the many things you delivered us from. We come to return thanks to you. We come to return thanks to you. You've been so good. You've been so faithful. I want to thank you. Thank you for my family. Thank you for this church. Thank you for this nation. Thank you for this state. Thank you for this country. Thank you for this continent. Thank you for life itself. We appreciate you. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. This is one of those occasions where you have Christmas and New Year's Eve falling on Saturday and Sunday. And so what I have is that I'm going to start a message tonight and I will finish tomorrow. I'm not under pressure. I'm not in a hurry. But since I know everybody wants to shout at 12 o'clock, I'll try and stop at 12 so you can shout. Amen. But let me read something to you which I think Pastor Kunle, both Kunle's hit the nail on. Enduring businesses have one thing in common, a core purpose. All companies, including Walmart, Disney, Sony, and all those, have one purpose. Most of you don't know this. Israel has a core purpose. The purpose of Israel is to provide a secure place on earth for the Jewish people. They're very clear in their minds what they're doing. Israel is the most creative nation on the face of the earth today. It has more startups per capita than America. It's one of the most successful countries in the world today in technology and in technology advancement. When Kunle began to pray that prayer this morning, that if you don't have a purpose for your life, we spent the whole year studying purpose. You haven't started living. You haven't started living. And my prayer tonight is, whatever it takes, you're going to walk intentionally this year. Amen? I don't know what's wrong with the technology, but let me walk you through a few things that have been on my mind since morning. Unless you are living under the moon, you will know that the world has changed. We just recently found, I'm reviewing 2016. Unbelievable. I think I was in my bedroom a few months ago, my wife and I, watching television, and the votes were being counted in America, and right before my very eyes, Donald Trump overtook Mrs. Clinton. A few months before then, Brexit had happened. What was considered to be impossible happened. Countries that you weren't expecting to do anything, things happened. There were bombings all over the world. In Paris, many bad things happened. And a few days ago, some gentleman put on social media and said, people are dying in Aleppo in Syria, and nobody's praying, but few people died in Paris, and people are crying. And Dr. Adegbola said this to me. He said, Pastor Francis, do you notice that in 2001, during the September 11 bombing, nobody saw a picture of a dead body in 2001. You notice that? You notice in Paris that recently there was a bombing, nobody saw dead bodies of people who died in that bombing. But anything that happens in our country, we put it on Facebook and on social media. We have no regard for human life, no dignity for human life. Because we still don't know that the purpose of a nation is for its people. Amen? Amen? And so we've had a horrible, horrible, tough year. And let's come home. Nobody in this auditorium, including Pastor Ladiron, the banker, would have believed that the dollar to the naira would be 500 to 1 on the average. Who would have known that last year? Huh? Who would have believed it? Who would have believed that petrol will be whatever it is today? As of yesterday, the man who supplies us diesel said he wasn't going to supply diesel to us except it's 220 naira per liter. And I told my accountant not to argue with him, let him bring the diesel so we can have our watch night service. Only for me to find out yesterday that there are some companies bought diesel for 255 naira per liter, 240 naira per liter. And the problem is that when all these things are happening, you know what we do? We climb on Facebook and climb on social media and we begin to write whatever we want to write, say whatever we want to say. And what we are beginning to misunderstand is that there is something about God that is uniquely sovereign. He is not moved by circumstances. He is not moved by stories. And that's why I want to introduce you to this word that says, nevertheless. Nevertheless is a very funny word. It's like you say, the roads, for instance, I can say this, the road to my village is horrible, but nevertheless, I will take the journey. Do you understand it? Am I making sense? In other words, things are not good. Things are not fair. Things are not wonderful, but I will still do it anyway. Now, in life, if you keep thinking about it, if you keep looking at what is happening around you, 500 to 1, dollar, and you keep reading Facebook, and you keep reading the newspapers, and you keep listening to everything that is being reported out there, whose report would you believe? Do you know we were told recently that even Facebook was accused of putting up fake news. You heard that? So that means 90% of what you see or hear or read on Facebook and on social media and even in the newspapers are not accurate. Amen? But you have a book that has been written by God that is 100% accurate, but you don't read it. Are you here? You know, in the Bible, I'm going to quickly just walk you through some examples. I'll go into specifics in a minute when they have the projector up, but let me go generally. There's some stories in the Bible. You see, this is the problem with the Bible. When you read the book of Acts, you actually think that miracles were happening on a daily basis. They weren't. Sometimes the miracles in the Bible span 20 years. Some of them span 17 years. That's the problem with us. When you read the Bible, you think the miraculous were happening every single day. They woke up in the morning and an angel appeared. They woke up in the afternoon and an angel appeared. No, no, no. The Bible, it was as real as it is for us today. David, at the age of 17, was anointed to be king. 13 years later, he still hadn't gotten to the throne. If you were the one, wouldn't you have given up? I'm asking you. Another young man, Joseph, got up at the age of about 14, 15, 16. And he had a dream that he was going to rule over his, not only his brothers, but even over his parents. Because the dream said the sun, moon, and stars bow down to him. His father and his mother were the sun and moon. His brothers were the stars. Am I making sense? Yet, how many years later, if you were in jail, like Joseph was, would you still think that thing's going to come to pass? I'm asking you. If the dollar is 500, if Naira is 500 to 1, and God told you that he was going to use you to do something wonderful, and the situation is bad, would you still believe it? I'm asking you. Hannah, how many years was she going to the temple, or let me say Holy Ghost service? How many years was she going every first Friday of the month? Talk to me now. No child. And when she got back, people were making fun of her. Am I right? I've gone past all this now. I've gone past all this. All right? Are you here? The fulfillment of God's promise and the realization of God's purpose is only a matter of time. Some of you have been waiting for the fulfillment of God for a long time. There are some of my girls in this auditorium whom every year I will say, this is the year you're going to get married. One of them, this is the year you're going to have a child. This is the year this is going to happen to you. Even me, there are many disappointments in my life. And we're doing it again. 2017 is the year of... Am I right? 2017, the Lord is going to do this, going to do that. You see, that's why I want to bring this message to you. I'm going to skip all this. I'm going to skip this too. Skip all that. I'm going to go to where I want to go. Let's start from here. Luke chapter 5, verses 1 to 8. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little bit to the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. And when he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let your nets down for a catch. But Simon answered unto him and said, Master, the economy has been bad in 2016. It's 500 to 1. Oh Lord, listen. Everything I planned last year, nothing worked. All my efforts were in vain. I couldn't even pay my children's school fees. I'm paraphrasing. Are you here? Did he complain or not? But what did he say next? What? At your word. Kunle said, most of us don't have a word. What is your word? What word are you standing on for this new year? Not what are the newspapers saying. You know, one a gentleman this evening listed the prophecies of one Suleiman or something, one Apostle Suleiman in Lagos. And he said all you had to do to prophesy was for you to read, to listen to CNN. The man said, Glo and MTN will have problems this year. Who doesn't know that? Some people will die of this. Some people will die of a car crash. Who doesn't know that? What did he say? Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down my net. And what happened? You know what happened. Let me skip all that. Go to the next one. Numbers chapter 13. You see, that's a positive nevertheless. Let's look at a negative nevertheless. Numbers chapter 13, verse 27 to 28. And they told him and they said, we went into the land that you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey. And this is the fruit. They literally carried the fruit on their shoulders. Two people had to carry the fruit. Can you imagine carrying mangoes, using a bag to carry mangoes home to explain to people the fruitfulness? But what did they say? What did they say? The same word. Nevertheless, the people that dwell in the land, those politicians will never allow this country to prosper. Are you here? I don't mind them in Abuja. They will never do anything. Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong. The cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Enoch, and most of you know what they said. They said, they were giants in our sight, and we were grasshoppers in their own sight. Nigeria can never change, you. Nigeria will change, because it could possible. One word. One word. Can I continue? Look at this one. We're going to take only this because these are going to be our prayer points. We're already running out of time. There are already 7 more minutes. And he went a little further, Mark chapter 14, verse 35, and fell on the ground and prayed and said, if it were possible that this hour may pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away. Hey! If God has said amen there, we will be lost forever. But you know what he said? Nevertheless. I'm going to stop there for tonight. Single word. Just one word. Nevertheless. Just one word. It's a transition. It's a powerful word. That's what we're going to start from tonight. I said tonight is a night of prayers. I'm not preaching. The first thing I want you to do is if you've been doing everything that has been wrong, like in Numbers, where you've made some stupid statements. You know what God said to them? You know what God said to them in Numbers? As you have spoken in my hearing. They were not praying, no. Most of us think God only hears us when we pray. When you are doing... Heaven was recording it. That's what we're going to start from tonight. There is almost nobody here, including me, who hasn't said stupid things about this nation. Talk to me now. There's almost nobody here tonight who hasn't given up on this land. Am I right? We're going to reverse it tonight. Are you here? Are you ready? I want you to stand with me, please. We're running out of time. I want you to run. I'm going to continue from here tomorrow, but we'll see what happens tonight. Just lift up your voice to the Lord. Numbers, see what they did. I'm so sorry for doubting you, Lord. I'm so sorry for every negative nevertheless in my life. I don't want it to enter into 2017. Some of you, I've spoken to some people here in this church. Give your wife a chance or give your husband a chance. Never! That's one word. Never. But tonight you're going to say, Father, I repent. Come on, join me now, please. Come on. Lord, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I am so sorry. No, none of this is following me to the new year. My provost stood up. God said, as you have said it in my hearing. Remember Peter, he denied Jesus 3 times. And Jesus made him confess. How many times? 3 times. Every negativity, everything, hope I have lost in this nation, restore. The Bible says hope is an anchor for your soul. Restore my hope. Not in the nation, in you. That you can do anything. I'm so sorry for not trusting you, oh God. I'm so sorry for believing anything that wasn't from you. I'm asking you to forget me. Forgive me, oh God. Forgive me, oh God. I said I can't make it in this economy, but I can. I said this economy is not good for business, but it is. Ah, Lord, it is because you are God. Now I have to move on a little bit. I'm so sorry. I've got to move a little bit faster. Now let's go to the next one. Next one was the one of Peter. Listen to me. God is going to give you instructions in the next few minutes. How many of you have ever, because this is my job or my profession or what I do for a living, people will come and meet you with problems and you would tell them the solutions to their problems, Pastor Ladiron, and then they will begin to argue with you. Kuna, you know what I'm talking about? Okay, why don't you move this business and go and do this? Hey, Pastor, you know. Or you tell them to do something, they'll say, no, Pastor's not going to work. Have you tried it? I remember one guy in Jill's embassy many years ago. His car used to break down. He used to embarrass us in all our meetings. He was an architect. And I said to him, please go and get another car. Sell your car and buy another car. You know what he said to me? He said, I can't afford it. I said, how much is a new car? He said, he doesn't know. How much can you get for your old car? He said, he doesn't know. I said, how do you know you can't afford it? You're going to say to God tonight, Father, anything you tell me tonight, from tonight, any instruction you give me, I am not going to be moved by my circumstances. I'm not going to be moved by the country. If you say build, I will build. If you said give, I will give. If you say I'm marrying this year, I'm marrying this year. If you say I'm multiplying this year, I'm multiplying this year. If you say I'm going to be debt free this year, I'm going to be debt free this year. If you said this is the way forward, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it, oh God. Lord, I believe you. Like Peter did. At your word. 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 Begin to turn my negativity. Begin to turn every negative circumstance. And begin to turn them. And begin to turn them by the power of your word. I begin to turn them in the name of Jesus. No, I'm not moved. It's not. This naira will work for me. This dollar will work for me. This dollar will work for me. This thing that they call recession will work for me. This opportunity will work for me. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. This will work for me. Now the last one is the one I shared with you about Jesus himself. Why am I saying this? Listen to me, ladies and gentlemen. It's not your will. I told you everywhere I traveled this last 6 weeks. They said to me, Pastor, why do you people believe so much in prayer in Nigeria? And nothing is changing. And I said, it's because of the way we've interpreted prayer. Prayer is not you sending God on an errand. Prayer is God sending you on an errand. I'm going to listen to his will and I'm going to do it. Jesus said, I want this cup to be taken away. How many of you don't want Nigeria not to be in recession? Who doesn't want Nigeria to be better? Who doesn't want dollar 1-to-1? Who doesn't want things to be better around them here? Talk to me now. Who doesn't? But you're going to have to get to a place with God this year where you're going to say, Father, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Yes, I want the economy to be better. Yeah, I want the dollar to be better. But nevertheless, let your will. God is getting something out of this recession. God is getting something out of Trump. God is getting something out of Brexit. God is getting something out of the recession that's happening right now. We have never seen Nigerians who, for the first time in the history of this country, there's accountability. If there was no recession, so please, it's God. I don't care anymore. I'm not going to keep praying, God, bring this down. I'm going to say, Lord, let your will be done. Let's pray that tonight. For my life, let your will. Yeah, I want to get married this year, but let your will be done. I want to own this year, but let your will be done. I want this to happen, but let your will be done. I want this to happen, but let your will be done. I want this to happen. Ah, neko sopanam brava sotonam basatala. Rido sopanamako abrovosto tulabasa. Mando sotosto paradai. Grido stopanamamba panama. Inda gakita. Let your will. Let your will. I will not be afraid. I will not be afraid anymore. I'm not afraid to step into 2017. I'm not afraid of the circumstances anymore. I'm not afraid of Facebook. I'm not afraid of the false news. I'm not afraid of whatever is happening around me. Because the will of God, it alone shall stand. Father, I believe you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now sit down for a minute. Happy New Year. I have about 10 more minutes. But I want to stop and greet everybody. Greet your neighbor. Happy New Year. Happy to have. Welcome to 2017. Welcome to 2017. Congratulations. Congratulations. Happy New Year, ma. Happy New Year, ma. Happy New Year, my sister. God bless you. Nice to see you. Happy New Year, my sister. Happy New Year. Happy New Year, my brother. Happy New Year. Happy New Year. Hallelujah. Now settle down, settle down. Pastor Smith will do all the dancing in a minute. Praise the Lord. Let me finish. All right, like guys, sit down. All right, thank you. Eshegon, sit down. The difference between 2016 and 2017 is a fraction of the second you were told. Praise the Lord. Now I want to close. This is our psalm for this year. Psalm 144, verse 1. I'm not going to spend time on it. This is the full version of the psalm. It says, Blessed be the Lord, my rock, who trains my arms for battle, who prepares my hands for war. But I tell her to add the second verse. He is my love, my fortress. He is my stronghold, my savior, my shield, and my place of refuge. But let me stay where I want to go now. Now, please, there are many versions of this things. Where you see, praise the Lord, who is my rock, some translation will say, praise the Lord, who is my strength. And so I don't have to go back to the area of strength because Mrs. Oladere, but the Spirit of God has already led you in the prayer of that. So I'm not going to spend time on that, but let me go to where I want to go. This is what the Lord began to do. I want you to notice, he says, he uses the word trains. I'm so happy that my sister, she's ministered to us here before, is here. But she will tell you that there's a big difference between teaching and training. Teaching is giving instructions like we're doing right now. I've all told everybody, say this, pray this. You've all done it. It's easy to do. But training is different. Training requires for you to do something. Training is not listening to lectures. You see, in Hebrews, the Bible says, whatever happened to Israel, happened to them as ensamples. The old King James uses the word ensamples. And he uses that word very carefully because the word ensample is different from the word example. The word example means I can give you an example, but if I want to show you an ensample, I have to act it out. Are you here? Are you here? Now, this is the problem. This is what the Lord said to me. The Lord said to me, whenever, and this, I've been a born-again Christian from the age of 11. So I've been in this business a little while, almost 44 years. And he said, every time, son, you read this scripture, you always attribute it to spiritual warfare, and you are right. He said, however, I'm going to show you a dimension that you haven't seen before. He said to me, praise the Lord, who is my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle. And he said to me, anytime you see the word hands in the Bible, it has to do with skill. Look at another version of it. Yeah, look at it. He says, he trains my hands for war and gives my fingers what? The Lord said, don't you fight for market share? Don't you fight for life? Don't you fight for your nation? Don't you fight for your children? Don't you fight for your marriage? Don't you fight for the things? You see, the devil will never allow even the blessings of God to come upon you automatically. It is his job to frustrate you. He said to me, I want you to see a dimension here that you haven't seen before. He said to me, I, this year, I'm going to train you myself. Listen to me. Not teach you. You see, I'm going to... Daddy Smith is here. Sir, they are over, I don't know whether I'm right or not. How many would think that there are about 200,000 churches in Nigeria? More than that? Huh? How many Christian universities do we have? Adamilon. Emeka, how many Christian universities? About 5. Christian universities. 10? Christian, not, I'm not saying university. How many Christian faith-based universities do we have? Huh? Okay, let's say 20. Okay, there are 20 Christian universities, 200,000 churches. Not one of them has sound engineering in their department. Sir, we found out that MTN paid us $250 million, sir. As of last year, they had taken $12.5 billion out of the country. Now, they invested, please don't misunderstand me. They invested more than the $250 billion. But do you know why they carry our money away? We don't have the skill to do any of the things they do. In Abuja, a few years ago, they were looking for 1,000 deep-sea divers to do a project. They couldn't find. 180 million Nigerians. They couldn't find 1,000 deep sea divers. So they went to China and brought 1,000 deep sea divers and paid them in foreign exchange. God says our problem is that we lack skill. The Bible says he is the one who gives you the ability to create wealth. He's the one that gives you the skill to create wealth. I'm going to stop here. This is going to be the last. Let me just show you something. A battle is a small part of a war sorry, a battle is a small part in a war, and a war is made up of several battles. Battle is actually fight. Sorry, let me leave all that. But the point I'm trying to bring here is that there's a different, the Bible is very clear to accept, there's a difference between war and battle. And the Bible quickly distinguishes it. I don't have time to teach on that. I'll do that tomorrow. But let me stop and say this to you. Listen to me. I believe, listen to me, that God wants to give us skills this year if we will yield to his training. I had the opportunity of going to visit Niji Farms with Pastor Olumide a few days ago. Up somewhere, I don't know where it is. Is it Kogi State or I don't know what state it is. Sir, 1 ton of cassava they harvested and produced every single day. There were trucks waiting to collect it, and people said there are no jobs in Nigeria. We don't know how to do anything. We don't know how to do things. God says, this year, you will yield to my training, not my teaching. Church is good at teaching. It's not good at training. This year, God says it is what? Training. God will determine your course. He will determine your lecturer. He will determine your the course you're going to run through. I was telling a couple the other day. I said, in the morning during youth service, at 6 o'clock in the morning, they blow their whistle. Do you get up? Adamilo. Good. Then at 7 o'clock, you have to get to the cafeteria. If you don't get to the cafeteria before 8, the food is over. Am I right? Lunch is only served between 1 and 2 in camp. Am I right? Then in the evening, between 7 or 6 and 7 or 7 and 8, if you don't eat, you've lost your meal. Then at 10 o'clock, you at Bayer, they will put off the light and tell you light off. Am I right? That's training. Some of you will get up in the morning, time to pray. Lord, I'm tired. You know you're merciful. Praise the Lord, who is my rock. He trains my hand to war. Stand up, please. Pastor Smith, I'm ready to give it. The first thing I had to do with everybody for the 3-day fasting and praying was, can you accept God's training this year? Would you accept God's training? Would you accept God's training? Adam alone. Oh, they're saying yes now because it's 2017 at the beginning. Huh? Adam alone. You know, the Bible says, I think it's in Hebrews, or one of the scriptures that says, he disciplines his child. How many of you have heard that before? Huh? That's a wrong interpretation. That word discipline is what universities call training. But when you get to university, they say, what is your discipline? It's not enough to know your purpose. It's important that you get trained in your purpose. Or else you won't fulfill it. You won't fulfill it. As a young lady in this church, or who used to be in this church, and I'm going to tell you this story and I'm going to close. She did her youth service in Ilorin. She called me. She was offered Montessori training that was costing 400,000 naira for 250 naira discount. And she called me and said, should she do it? I said, yes. If you spend 250,000 training for the next 6 months, your minimum salary as a Montessori teacher will be 150,000 naira a month. Are you listening to me? Hear what I said. 400,000 training discounted to 250,000 because she's going to be working while she's training. But she didn't have the 250,000. I said, okay, I will pay part of it if you will cut down on some of your expenses. Like that BlackBerry you carry. Like that hair that costs you 25,000 naira every month. Like that, come on, I'm sorry, that's the way I am. I'm sorry, I'm Abinu, don't come to me. I said, if you can cut down on some of your bill, I will contribute towards your training. She said she would think about it. She didn't take the job. she took up the job as, what they call those people who answer phones for MTN, customer care. You know how much they're paying her? 50,000 naira a month. Now, if she had done 6 months training at 250,000 naira, 6 months later, she would have had 900,000 naira. She would have paid off her 250,000 naira loan and her life would have been better. We run away from training because training is difficult and tough. Batayadu koka. How many of us, our lives would have been better if we did first class in school? Talk to me. How many of us would have been better off if we had first class? How many scholarships would we have had? What training would we have been exposed to? How many of us, if we had 2-1, would have been better off than we are now? Some of us are here because we had third class. Anika, we kiche kwe alogbon. Father, train me this year. By your spirit, send laborers across my pathway. Those who will perfect whatever is lacking in my faith. Father, in the name of Jesus, I yield to your training this year. In the name of Jesus. And I can live an life of intentional purpose this year. Just one scripture and I'm going to close. Is it moving? I don't know why it's not moving. One scripture, quickly. Somebody move this forward. What's happening? Go forward. I'm going to close on one scripture. That's all. Go on. Just keep going. I'll tell you when to stop. Go on. Just keep going. Okay, wait. Go back. One step at a time. Go back. Yes, go back. One more. Forward now. Now, this is 1 Kings chapter 5. I want to show you something. Go back one scripture. Look at what it says. Now, therefore, that they cut down cedars for me from Lebanon, and my servants will be with your servants, and I will pay you what? For your servants, according to what? In other words, I'm going to pay you not what it is worth, but what you are asking for. You didn't hear what I said? Pastor, can you come and speak in my church? Yes. How much do you want? 1 million naira. Okay. Pastor, come on, speak in my church. What do you want? 1.5 million. What? Okay. Pastor, come on, speak in my church. What do you want? 3 million. Okay. Come and do this job for me. What do you want for the job? 5 million. Okay. He says, you determine how much you earn. Why? Go to the next verse. Go to the next scripture. For you know, there is none amongst us who has what? Even scripture, God said to David, said, play, choir members, he said, play skillfully. We've been getting away with a lot of rubbish in this country. God is bringing standards back. Let me tell you something. I went to a place called Amazon Go. How many of you remember Amazon? I showed the pictures. Amazon Go, no cashier. As soon as you walk into the shop, you put on your phone. It automatically knows you have arrived. When you pick up goods from the shelf, it debits your account immediately. When you return the good back to the shelf, it returns it to your account. Then when your bag is full and you walk out of the scanner in front of the door, it summarizes everything you took and your pay. No cashier, nobody to do anything for you. You do everything. When I put the picture up, some very zealous Nigerians in America started criticizing me and saying, that thing is going to put people out of a job. Why are you encouraging it? I said, whether they like it or not, they're going to do it. But the person that is making the money is the one that is designing the machine. How many of you remember vinyl records? 45 rotations per minute. 36 rotations per minute. Remember that? Where are they today? Even CD has gone. Father, the skills I need for 2017, in the name of the Lord Jesus, the skills I need for this new year, the skills I need for this economy, the skills I need for this atmosphere that's about this country right now, in the name of Jesus, I'm opening myself up to you. Come. Come, oh God. Come, oh Lord. And do what you've set your heart to do. In the mighty name of Jesus. Bow your heads. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. I know. I know. I know. And when you receive a word like this, the first thing that floods your mind are the current problems you're facing. I know that when you hear a word like this, your mind begins to run around and say, Lord, why don't you solve this one first? But the Bible says if you are willing and obedient, you will eat the good of the land. I want you right now to just say to God, just carry every weight you've been carrying from 2016. Tell him tonight he's not entering into 2017 with you. Yeah, I know the load is heavy, but God has given you a way of escape. Ah, nakosoto, mbafana, stoto, palana, kiata. You don't need a better landlord in 2017. You need your own house. You don't need somebody to borrow you money for rent. You need skills that will generate the money you need. You don't need any of those patchwork that you've been using to survive for the last year. Now God wants to establish you. Establish you. Establish you. Establish you. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we release our challenges in 2016 and we say, oh God, they will not enter into 2017. Right now, in the name of Jesus, we receive from heaven the grace, the favor, and the ability to be able to obey you this year and to do according to your will. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.